Hey, City Hill. I'm Justin Thill, and this is my wife, Joanna.
Hey, Guy.
And here are our four adorable, highly energetic young boys. We've been attending City Hill for about 9 years, so about the same amount of time as we have been in quarantine. We are so excited to be here with you today via our own Facebook page to kick off the service. One thing that initially drew us to City Hill was the huge sense of community we felt the first day we came.
Speaking of the amazing community at City Hill, we just want to say thank you. Thank you for your prayers, your meals, your check-ins during these past few months. Our year started out a little rough with several serious health issues in our family, and we have so appreciated all the love and support our City Hill family has shown us. We have definitely been covered in prayer, and that has helped us immensely as we have gone through this difficult time.
Yes, we have truly felt the Father's love through each one of you, and we are so thankful for this church. That's enough about us. Let's get this service started. We want to welcome you to City Hill's Sunday morning service. If this is your first time joining us, you can connect us via Facebook, our City Hill YouTube channel, Instagram, and cityhill.org.
Before we engage in a time of praise and worship, let's reflect on these scriptures. John 7:38. Whoever believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. John 4:13-14. Jesus said to her, everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks of the water that I will give him will never be thirsty again. The water that I will give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life.
So with that, let's enter into worship. Again, thank you for joining, and we are looking forward to the day we can see you all in person.
Thank you, Thole family, for that awesome welcome. Welcome, City Hill family, to our online service this morning. As we come into worship, I just want to encourage you to stand up, find a way to be comfortable in your home to worship with us. Feel free to dance, feel free to clap, explore the freedom that you have in worship this morning, and join us as we lift up praise together. Amen. Let's worship together this morning. Cover all my
Ephesians 1:3-8. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ, for he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us to be adopted as his sons through Jesus Christ in accordance with his pleasure and will, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us and the one he loves. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins in accordance with the riches of God's grace. Ephesians 1:3-8.
Is yours, and my hope is in you only, and my heart you hold, 'cause you made this sinner holy. Your glory is so beautiful, I fall onto my knees in awe, and the heartbeat of my life is to worship you in your light, 'cause your glory is so beautiful, 'cause your glory is so beautiful.
We lift you up.
Glory, glory.
love you, Jesus.
Psalm 20, 1 to 2, 5 to 9. May the Lord answer you when you are in distress. May the name of the God of Jacob protect you. May he send you help from the sanctuary and grant you support from Zion. May we shout for joy over your victory and lift up our banners in the name of our God. May the Lord grant all your requests. Now this I know, the Lord gives victory to his anointed. He answers him from his heavenly sanctuary with the victorious power of his right hand. Some trust in chariots and some in horses, but we trust in the name of the Lord our God. They are brought to their knees and fall, but we rise up and stand firm. Lord, give victory to the King. Answer us when we call. Psalm 20, 1 to 2, 5 to 9.
The weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. And when the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. Oh, my God will never fail. My God will never fail. And I'm gonna seek victory. I'm gonna seek victory. For the
battle belongs to you.
Victory, and therefore we can have hope and we can get through anything that happens here on this earth, Lord, because Jesus, you had the victory. So we have hope in this day, we have hope in this moment. We pray that we would not forget our hope, Lord. We, as your sons and daughters, we would not forget our hope that we have that comes from you, Jesus. You are so awesome, and we just give you glory in this place, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Thanks for worshiping, church. Kiddos, you have a special, special moment with Janet coming up, so come on close to the screen.
Hey, City Hill kids. Today I am planting flowers I purchased at a garden center. Aren't they beautiful? I want to make my mother-in-law's flower garden beautiful for her. She loves flowers, and she used to enjoy planting this flower garden every spring. But now she's 93 years old, she can't walk. It's hard for her to bend over and kneel down to do the work that it takes to plant the garden like she used to. So I'm going to plant her flowers for her. I think it's going to put a big smile on her face. This month, we're learning all about determination, deciding it's worth it to finish what you've started. I'm determined to finish planting these particular begonias on this front row of Norma's garden today. Now, there are a number of obstacles. Do you know what obstacles means? Well, obstacles are things that get in your way, that stop you from finishing what you've started. So some obstacles to me completing my goal of planting these flowers would be the hot sun. I mean, I could get so hot and sweaty that I would quit before I'm finished. Also, the number of plants. If you look at my 8-pack here, and I've got 3 of them, 3 times 8, I have to plant 24 flowers. I could get so tired, my knees could get so sore that I would just give up before I'm finished. Are you doing something this week that requires determination? Maybe it's finishing your school year. Distance learning can be really hard, can't it? Maybe it's finishing a project, either for school or something that you're doing at home, like baking a cake, putting together a Lego set, or building something in your backyard. Maybe it's practicing an instrument, or learning to ride your bike, or working really hard to excel at a sport that you love. What are some obstacles in the way of finishing what you've started? Our memory verse this month is like a cheer for us to encourage each other to not quit, to not give up. Galatians 6:9 says, let us not become tired of doing good. At the right time, we will gather a crop if we don't give up. If you've ever helped your parents plant a vegetable garden, you know that it takes a lot of work to plant the seeds, water the seeds, protect the little seedlings from the rabbits and the deer, pull up the weeds that grow right along with the seeds, and water the seeds some more. Water the plants until they grow to maturity and produce a crop of vegetables that you can actually eat. So my project will literally grow a crop of beautiful flowers if I don't give up. I mean, if I continue after planting today to water them, to weed them, I'm going to have a beautiful flower garden to show to Norma. When you think of the project that you're determined to finish, what do you think your crop or end result will be if you don't give up? Well, if you're baking something, the end result is that you get to enjoy the cake with your family, or maybe give it to a neighbor. If you're practicing an instrument, the end result may be that you get to play on the youth worship band. Being able to ride your bike with your family or play sports with a team at school, all good results from not giving up. Today's Bible story tells about Peter and John facing a number of big obstacles, like prison, because they're telling people that Jesus was the Messiah and the only way to God. They were able to keep going because they knew that God was with them and that nothing could ever separate them from God's love. They also knew that if they didn't grow tired of doing the right thing, many more people would become part of God's family and receive the eternal life that Jesus promised his followers. And that's a great big crop they wanted to gather, right? So, whatever you've started, don't quit. Be determined to finish it. And pray to God for the help that you need. His Holy Spirit will help you finish what you've started. And now, I'm gonna try to finish what I've started and plant these beautiful flowers. I can't wait to show you my finished flower garden.
Good morning, City Hill children. I know you're still with us, so I want you to try to figure out, where am I right now? I'll give you some clues during these announcements. First announcement. In June, we are having a special communication seminar every Tuesday night at 8:30 p.m. Yes, I said 8:30 p.m. I know it's late, but for people with kids, that might be the only free time that you have after bedtime. So put the kids down and come out. This is going to be an awesome time. One note, if you're coming as a couple or as a family, everyone needs their own device. We're doing this via Zoom, which opens it up to the whole world, but we also want to have some neat times of breakout sessions and communicating with other people and some really fun exercises. So everyone's going to need their own device. I'm going to send out an email this week. Make sure to sign up. Also, use this as an opportunity for outreach. If you have people in your life that maybe are struggling in their relationships and need to figure out kind of God's way of communicating and expressing love, invite them. This is going to be a great time. So that's every Tuesday in June, 8:30 p.m. Sign up after I send out my email this week and get excited. Did you figure out where I am yet? Maybe this will help. Our next announcement is August 15th and 16th is City Hill's 50th anniversary. So I want all of you, if you have friends, family, who have been a part of the history of City Hill, whether they're near or far, give them a call, shoot them an email, say, hey, come out. We want to celebrate and remember. We want to hear old stories and new stories of what God has done and how faithful he has been through this local body. So that's August 15th and 16th. It's going to be a barbecue Saturday, special worship on Sunday, and a special worship night with worship songs through the ages. It's going to be a great time. So invite friends, invite family from near and far to come out. Now, I hope you know where I am. The playground. Let's enter into a time of tithes and offerings. Now, as you probably know, and as will be on the screen somewhere, some direction, you can give online at cityhill.org/give. through text to give, the number on the screen. There's many other options. You could send in a check to the mail, however you want. But again, we've been so blessed in so many ways, even during this time of quarantine, and it's been really neat to see so many people in our church step up to help one another, to support one another, whether they need supplies or funds or anything. It's been really beautiful. So thank you and great job, City Hill. So let's just pray and let's bless this time of offering. God, we thank you. We thank you for how you've so richly blessed us. We thank you, and we just acknowledge that everything we have is yours. Our money, our time, our talents, our relationships, our homes. God, everything is yours. And we just want to recognize that by giving back a portion of what you've entrusted us with for the work of your kingdom. So God, bless this funds and all the other things, God, given by this body, whether it's in the church or in the world. God, bless it and multiply it for the expansion of your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen. Have a great morning, City Hill. Bye.
Well, good morning, City Hill. It's great that we can be together through Facebook, through YouTube, but we're together as a church. We may be kind of like the church dispersed, but we are the church of Jesus Christ here at City Hill this morning. And you know, my heart is overflowing with thankfulness. Just the realizing what God is doing, that even in the middle of this COVID crisis, that God is at work. And my heart is full of thankfulness this morning. You might say, really? Like, for what? Well, all sorts of things. Like, I'm thankful for our worship team, that God's given us a group of really talented musicians who truly love Jesus. I'm grateful for the spring weather. Isn't it nice that we can be out in this beautiful weather? And when we're supposed to be in our homes, at least we can get outside. We can get outside and enjoy the beauty of God's creation. I'm thankful for that. I'm thankful for my health, that I can ride a bicycle, that I can go skiing, that I can play golf. I'm grateful for the health that God has given me. I'm grateful for my friends, church family. I'm grateful for the generosity of this church. You know, even in these shutdown times, the giving and the generosity of this church has been strong. Thank you. But I'm grateful to the Lord for you, that we've not had to lay anybody off, and that God is continuing to provide what we need as a church body. That's a wonderful thing, and I'm grateful to the Lord for that. Probably most of all, I am grateful for the presence of God in my life. The psalmist says in a prayer to God, he says, "Cast me not away from your presence, and don't take your Holy Spirit from me." As I read those verses, I thought, what would that be like? I can't even imagine. And I'm so grateful for the Spirit of God that dwells in me and in you, and that we can be grateful for that Emmanuel, God with us, that he has not left us nor forsaken us in these challenging times. And I'm grateful for that. And let me just tell you, if you can't think of anything to be grateful, then something wrong with you. That's right. You need to get it together and say, Lord, forgive me for looking at all the problems, and God, thank you for your goodness to me. So just tell somebody beside you, in your home, wherever you are today, say, you know, I thank God for, and let that spirit of gratefulness and thankfulness arise in your heart. Let's pray as we get going this morning. Father, I thank you. I'm grateful, God, that with all the craziness around us, that you are still God. You are seated firmly on your throne, and I'm grateful for that, Jesus. And I thank you that you are the God who is with us, that you didn't leave us in trouble, but, Lord, you walk through it with us. Our hearts are grateful this morning. Be with us as we open your word. In Jesus' name, amen. I loved our Mother's Day service. Everybody driving in here, all the cars out in the parking lot. I love seeing people, the honking horns, the flashing lights. It was good that obeying the social distancing, we still had a chance to see each other, albeit from a distance. So thanks for coming out for Mother's Day, honoring the valiant women among us, the mothers who have cared so faithfully for their children. It was a good day. And, you know, I know the phrase, absence makes the heart grow fonder, normally speaks of a romantic couple and they're separated and their heart just breaks as they're apart. I realize that. But I would say that the absence of the church body has made my heart grow fonder for you. It's made me say, you know, we're not made to go to church virtually. God has made us to come together. That's why the scripture says, don't forsake the assembling together. We need each other. We need to be together, be it in small groups, be it here at this church. God calls us as his body. And I'm looking forward to those days. Hopefully not so far away. And you know, there's times with this COVID crisis and all the social distancing where I say, I am so done with that. Anybody out there done with that? You say, I'm done with it. That's on one hand. But on the other hand, we need to continue to love and care for the weak among us. We need to care for those who could be vulnerable. And so we keep a separation. Even though it's painful, we do it out of love and care for our neighbor, for our family, for those who are weak. And so we're walking through it. And the scriptures tells us that having done all to stand, stand. Just keep on standing. You can do it. God will give us the strength day by day. It also tells us don't grow weary in well-doing. So when you feel like, I just can't do this anymore, look to the Lord. He'll give you the strength for the next day, the next step, until we get through this thing. And I will tell you, we're making plans. We're looking at plans, strategies of how to regather as a church. Be praying for us. We want to walk in wisdom. We want to walk in honor of our government authorities. We're looking for God's direction of how we can begin to open the doors of the church and gather back together as his family. So we appreciate your prayers on those matters. Prior to Mother's Day, we were studying the return of Christ. It's a beautiful message. Maranatha, Jesus is coming soon. And as we studied that topic, many things popped out of the scriptures. One is that the return of Christ is soon. Now, we don't know when that soon is. It says nobody knows, only the Father. But Christ says, I come again soon. And the point of that really is that we are living at the ready, that we're ready for Christ. That we're not saying, no, I can live the way I want. It's going to be a long time. I got a long life. No, that's not the attitude that Christ wants of us. He wants us to live day by day ready for his return. And how do we ready ourselves? Well, one is we make sure our relationship with God is in order. Our prayer life is in order. We're people who day by day are talking to God and making sure that our relationship with him is good. Another way we do it is by using our talents, the gifts that God's given us. This worship team using their musical talents to lead us to the throne. People in business using their talents to earn money, to provide for their families, to care for those on the field, to produce things we need. I think of the medical professionals who are laying down their lives for people who are sick. All of these are ways that bring glory to God, and that's one of the ways that we keep our lives ready. Also, hospitality. It's amazing how important hospitality is because it reaches out to the stranger, to the foreigner, to the person who may really need help. We reach out in hospitality. All of those are ways that we ready ourselves for the return of Christ. And I like the little statement that when we walk outside and you see the sunset or a sunrise, I want to challenge you just to look up and say, maybe today, maybe today. Wouldn't it be amazing if the sky split today and Christ returned today? Maybe today. Be ready. Be ready, church. But I am not ready to leave this theme just yet. I want to return back to Matthew 24 because there were some very powerful, sobering aspects of this chapter that I believe are important for us as the church. Matthew 24, verse 3. As Jesus sat on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately saying, "Tell us, when will these things be, and what will be the sign of the coming, of your coming and the end of the age?" And Jesus answered them, "See that no one leads you astray. For many will come in my name, saying, 'I'm the Christ,' and they will lead many astray. And you will hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you are not alarmed. For this must take place, but the end is not yet. For nation will rise against nation, kingdom against kingdom. There will be famines and earthquakes in various places. All these are but the beginning of birth pains." So Jesus is with his disciples. And like you and me, they'd be gathered there at the Mount of Olives. And like you and me, they would have been curious. They have the Son of the living God right there with them. And they want to know, okay, how is this going to play out? What's going to happen? When is this going to happen? You're the Son of God. Tell us. And this is what Jesus says. He says, "See that no one leads you astray." Now, to me, I look at that somewhat like a warning label on the side of a package that says, you could be led astray, but see to it that that does not happen. And my heart and my prayer, and I would say to you this morning, see to it that you do not go astray. See to it that you're not among those who walk away from Christ. See to it that you are grounded on the Word of God so that you are among those who endure to the end. And I'd ask you the personal question, what would it take for you to go astray? How bad would it have to get for you to just chuck it, say, no more of this? What would it take for you? I hope you're thinking like me, well, there is nothing that would have me walk away from Christ. Praise the Lord. But even when I think about that, when I think about holding on to Christ, how can I hold on to Christ? The beauty is that in reality, it's Christ that's helping us. It's Him that's holding on to us. When I was in college or somewhere back around that age, I had a dream. And in the dream, I was holding on to the back of a speedboat. The speedboat was just crazy going around the lake, and I was just hanging on for dear life, hanging on to the back of that boat, but I was getting weary. And at one point, I just couldn't hold on anymore, and I fell away from the boat, but instead of bouncing off across the lake, I realized that someone had a hold of me. And when I woke up, the Lord said, "I've got you. I'm holding on to you. Yes, hold on with all your strength, but underneath us is the ever-loving arms of God that holds us when we're weary. And may we be those that are holding on to God, but also having Him hold on to us as we walk through very difficult times. And what Christ is saying in Matthew 24, He's giving us scriptures to say, look, this is what's going to happen. Don't fall away. This is what's going to happen. Don't be deceived. This is what's going to happen. Don't grow weary. You can make it. Together we can make it. And let's just be very clear. There is an enemy of our soul that wants to take us down. 2 Corinthians 2:11 says, in order that Satan might not outwit us, for we are not unaware of his schemes, which means we are aware of his plans. We've studied the enemy and we're ready. You know, when I preach, I like to talk about taking ground, advancing in the kingdom. And that's going to be next week's sermon. But there's also a place for any army to prepare itself defensively, to build its walls, to look and prepare against the attacks of the enemy. And one of the ways that Satan comes against us, one of his main ways of coming against you is through lies. We talked today a lot about fake news. The real fake news is what Satan brings to you, brings to attack you, to beat you up, to tear you down. He comes with lies, and we have to be prepared with truth. We have to be prepared with the Word of God so that when those lies come, we go, no way. This is what the Word of God says. We must be on our guard. You say, well, I don't know if I can win that war. Oh, yes, you can. How do I know that? Because the Scripture says that greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. It's not by your strength, but it's by the strength of the Lord Jesus Christ that you can win the battle. You must win the battle. Verse 13, but the one who endures to the end will be saved. My heart and my passion is that I would be one of those. My heart and my passion is that you would be one of those. That every one of us would be prepared for those hard times. I've asked myself really the question, as a father, did I prepare my sons for battle? Are we preparing our children for difficult times when things don't go as planned? I'm a person, I believe that God has great plans for us, abundant life for us, provision for us. He loves us. But I also believe that in this world, we're having tribulation. We will have tribulation. And we must prepare our people, our children, our own lives for times when things are difficult. I want to look at what it says is going to happen here in Matthew 24. Because if we've only told our children, prepared them that following Christ will be easy, if we say following Jesus will be beautiful, and that they will never have problems, that Jesus is the answer, will take away all their different challenges, we're not really giving the full gospel. Yes, Jesus takes away our problems. Yes, he helps us. Yes, he walks with us. But there are battles we must fight. And Jesus wanted to prepare his disciples. And my heart is that you as a disciple of Christ would also be prepared by the words of Christ. Because the reality is, at least my reality, living in America, is that we've not suffered a lot. We've not gone through really hard times. We've not been imprisoned. We've not been tortured. We've not been torn out of our homes. Things that Christians around the world have suffered, we, most of us, have not suffered in that way here in America. And so how do we make sure that we're among those who endure to the end? Well, first of all, we need to focus on Christ. Not just a focus on the enemy. We need to understand his plans. But our focus, our relationship, our strength must come from Christ. But we also must be defensive. I like reading about the Patriot missiles. The Patriot missiles are not missiles of attack. They are missiles of defense. And when the enemy throws warheads at us, the Patriot missile goes into the sky to intercept and blow those warheads out of the sky. It's a defensive missile. And today, my hope is that we could have some defensive missiles so when the enemy comes to take you down, you have your defenses ready. You're ready. So what are those? Well, we mentioned here. One is to be grounded on the Word of God. That never goes out of season. We need to be people that open the Word of God. You know, and I would just challenge you, every day open your Bible. If you only read a couple of verses, if you only read a chapter, praise the Lord. God will speak to you through His Word. We ground ourselves upon the Word so when the attack comes, the Word is alive in our souls. I'd say we also in America or around the world need to be aware and defend ourselves against universalism. It's coming more and more into the church and into America where we say, all roads lead to Rome. Actually, it's kind of a dumb thing to say because all roads do not lead to Rome, nor do all religions lead to God. Scripture makes it very clear that Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, the life. There's one way to the Father, and that's through Jesus Christ. So beware of that which would say there is no truth, and that all ways will lead to the heaven. Those would be lies, and we need to be aware of that. Jesus says that those who come in His name will do miracles. Don't be people who just see a gift and follow the person, because there can be false gifts. We need to be astute. We need to be wise in how we are interpreting the times. Interpreting those who may do miracles. Let's not be among those who are deceived. In Matthew 24, it says, wars will happen and rumors of wars. Wow, we will have wars like we don't know of. I think of the Second World War, the First World War, other wars around the world that have been devastating to those who have been affected by them. There will be a time of great wars around the world. Nations rise up against nations. The Bible says there will be famines. This won't be a lack of toilet paper. It's going to be a lack of everything, a famine where there's not food, where there's not water, where there's not supplies. Famine. Earthquakes. It will seem like the world is falling apart. I can imagine people saying the world is ending. And Jesus says these are but the beginning of birth pains. If you are a woman and you've ever given birth, you may have experienced what's called Braxton Hicks. I remember our first child, my wife was having these contractions. We thought, this is it. They said, nope. She said, man, this is horrible. I said, nope, this is bad, but it's not as bad as it's going to get. These are the beginning of birth pains. Verse 9, then they will deliver you up to tribulation, put you to death. You'll be hated by all nations for my name's sake. And many will fall away and betray one another, hate one another. And many false prophets will arise and lead many astray. And because lawlessness will be increased, the love of many will grow cold. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. Wow, I thought I couldn't get any worse. No, it gets bad for Christians, really bad, where people will turn on each other. I've seen people walk away from church because they say, well, those Christians are hypocrites. There are some Christians who are hypocrites, of course. But that doesn't have to affect your walk with Christ. If I see a Christian that's sinning or walking in a wrong direction, I'm saddened by that, But that does not give me an excuse or a reason to turn away from my faith in Christ. And what happens when the church and there's people who would be betraying one another? Betrayal would be one of the most horrible things in the world, because it's people who are to be your friends, your family, your loved ones. Betrayal, hated. Lawlessness. The love of many will grow cold. People will stop loving on each other. And I say, wow, could this be in our lifetime? Could the world really be that messed up? And Jesus says, yes, many will fall away because the cost of following Christ will be too great. I think for me, walking through that, the really hard part of that would be praying and not seeing the answers that I want to my prayers. I'd pray the war would end and it might not end. I'd pray that things would change and life would be very, very difficult. Tribulation. And I ask you the question, is your faith dependent upon God answering your prayers your way on your timetable? I know many that have prayed and haven't heard the answers, and therefore their heart grows cold against the Lord. Don't let that be your heart. May we be among those that when life gets very difficult, verse 21, then there will be great tribulation such as not been from the beginning of the world until now and never will be. And if those days had not been cut short, no human being would be saved. But for the sake of the elect, those days will be cut short. And then verse 29, immediately after the tribulation in those days, the sun will be darkened, the moon will not give its light, and stars will fall from heaven. Just when you thought it couldn't get any worse, it gets worse. And I read about that and think, I don't know how Christ could paint a more difficult, painful, troublesome world. And I think in those days, it would be easy to cry out and say, God, are you there? Do you love me? Have you gone asleep? What is going on? But God wants to put in us the heart of Job. And that's what I want to bring home today with all this negative talk. The heart of Job that says, though he slay me, yet will I praise him. I think God put in me that heart that would say, Lord Jesus, I am yours. You know, a number of years ago, I was playing, when I was in college, I played intramural football. And to end the game, the quarterback on our team, I don't know if he was hit, but he ended up on the ground and he was writhing in pain. Christian University. We drove my car, my station wagon on the field, put him in the vehicle, rushed him up to the emergency area. He quit breathing. They were trying to save his life. It seemed to me that at this moment, my friend was going to die. I was praying. I was crying out to God. I was rebuking the enemy. I did everything that I'd been trained to do as a Christian, and nothing was happening. And I had to move my car for the ambulance, which was showing up. And I remember I went out to my car, and I was in crisis. I was just in trauma. And I went out to the car, and I remember being mad at God. I said, God, I'm done. If you're not going to help, if you're not going to solve my problem, if you're not going to save my friend, then I'm done. I'm out. I quit. All by myself. And felt like the Lord kind of patted me on the back. Said, okay, so where are you going? I hadn't really thought it through very well. I just was mad. I said, well, I'm going to go be a Mormon. I thought, I don't even like white shirts. I'm going to go be a Muslim. I thought, I can't do that. I'm going to go be an agnostic. How could I do that? I'd experienced God. I knew God. I knew Christ. And all my options just seemed so futile. I just remember ending this wrestling with God, and it was like, all right, I'm in. I'm mad. I don't like it, but I'm in. And it was probably the closest in my life to answering like one of the disciples that said, "Where will we go? You have the words of eternal life." And God understands our anger. He understands our frustration. He understands our pain. And I would say to you this morning, for those of you who have walked through hard times, for those of you who have had physical sickness and pain and you've wrestled, or relational, marital problems, or you've walked through some really hard roads, God is not absent in your time of pain. He's the God that walks with us through these times. The answers don't always come as we want them to. But Christ says to us, "I will never leave you nor forsake you." And may we be among those that even when we walk through the pain of this life, that we've determined in our heart, by the grace of God, with the help of God, I'm in. I will be among those who will not fall away. I will be among those who will be faithful to the end. How do we get through? We hold on to the Word of God. How do we get through? We recognize the presence of God, which will sustain us in the difficult times. How do we get through? We walk with the body of Christ. We can't do it alone. We need each other. And this is true whether it be the end of the world, which will come someday, or whether this be a difficult time in your life. Together we can make it. Together we can walk with Christ, not be led astray, but be those who are faithful and endure to the end, in Jesus' name. Matthew 7, verse 24, I end with this. Everyone then who hears these words of mine and does them will be like a wise man who built his house on the rock, and the rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, but it did not fall because it had been founded on the rock. My prayer for you, for your family, for this church, is that we would be grounded upon the rock of the Lord Jesus Christ. We'd be ready for the wars and the battles that would come. It's not that they wouldn't be difficult, but that we'd be those who would endure as we hold on to the Lord Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name, amen. Father, I thank you that you give us the strength. It's not our strength. It's your strength, God. I thank you that you love us, that you walk with us, that you empower us. And as we hold on to you, Lord, you're holding on to us, and you'll give us the strength to walk through the battles and the difficult times. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I know that was a bit of a stronger, heavier message. Next week, I want to talk about how in the middle of battle, God calls us to advance. God calls us to have victory, how to take ground for the kingdom, even maybe especially when we're walking through difficult times. May God give you strength as you walk through this shutdown time in America. We're going to get through this together, and we're going to have the victory in the Lord Jesus Christ. Thanks so much. God bless. Like a